get started. Thank you. It is my great pleasure to welcome you to the Counting Race in quotation marks, Racial and Ethnic Measurements for the 2020 Census Symposium. My name is Nancy Lopez, and I'm an associate professor in the Department of Sociology. Along with Dr. Laura Gomez, who's currently on leave, I co-direct the Institute for the Study of Race and Social Justice at the Robert Wood Johnson Center for Health Policy. Before I introduce our distinguished panel of speakers and moderators, I'd like to say a few words about the mission of the Institute, the format of the symposium, as well as thank our co-sponsors. At this time, I respectfully ask that you silence your cell phones, and if you haven't done so already, there will be some clipboards going around to sign in. And before you leave, also please fill out the evaluation forms. Also very helpful for us. So now I'd like to talk a little bit about the mission of the Institute. Against the backdrop of ongoing and race-based inequalities in health, education, the criminal justice system, labor market outcomes, well, the importance of collecting and doing social scientific research on race, racialization processes, and racism remains one of the most important research challenges scholars, policymakers, and communities. There are some scholars that argue that since the Human Genome Project has found that there is no genetic basis for dividing the human species into genetic categories, we should no longer invoke the category of race in our research. We argue that although this is well-intentioned, this position may contribute to the maintenance of ongoing race-based inequalities and the status quo. In other words, just because something is not genetic does not mean that it does not exist as a social reality, as a social system of inequality that shapes the experiences of individuals and communities. Think about the social inequalities of class. That's not genetic. Gender, sexual orientation, disability, etc. So, to this end, we place the word race in quotes to underscore its nature as a dynamic and active multi-level and multi-dimensional social reality. That can be mapped at several different levels of society, first at the macro level, such as in law. For instance, the 2007 Supreme Court decision that dismantled desegregation programs, or in the mass media, such as the controlling images that we see that typically represent racially stigmatized minority groups in very negative light. Second, at the meso level, such as in institutional practice, such as tracking, disciplinary policies. And third, at the micro level, as in how you identify your, how you are daily identified by others, as well as microaggressions that you might encounter on a day-to-day basis. This has been shown to be even more significant than how you self-identify in terms of your health status. It is important to distinguish race from ethnicity. Ethnicity is also multidimensional, and it's a social construction. It refers to ideas of cultural background, practices, language, parental place of birth, generational status, and ancestry. For example, my ethnicity is Dominican. I was born in New York City, the daughter of immigrants from the Dominican Republic. Spanish is my first language. However, in most social circumstances, I am racialized as black in the United States context. If I were to just take a plane to the Dominican Republic, I would be put in the Trigueña category, which is in this intermediary category, and that has consequences for treatment. So what we're trying to understand as social scientists is how these social meanings get enacted in policies and practices. For more information on the Institute, I encourage you to visit our website. We have guidelines as well as information on some of the activities we've done, including an NIH workshop about operationalizing race and health policy, as well as some of the handouts that our speakers have circulated from the OMB and the Census. Now I'd like to say a few things about the format of the symposium. We decided to organize the symposium as two moderated roundtables with closing remarks in plenary format, rather than a traditional conference, because we felt that this format would be more conducive to a cross-fertilization of ideas and new ways of thinking about best practices. At the beginning of each roundtable, each speaker will have more than 10 minutes to answer the following question. Where should we be for the race and ethnicity question for the 2020 census? What are the best practices for the guidelines set by the Office of Management and Budget? If you could change one thing about the census that won't be, what would it be and why? What specific questions or protocols would you include? After the speakers have made their opening remarks, we will then have our moderators pose additional questions for 25 minutes, and the last 25 minutes will be for Q&A from our audience. We ask you to limit your questions to less than a minute, and of course the responses to less than 2 minutes, because that will maximize the time. At this point, I want to acknowledge our co-sponsors who worked very hard to make this happen. First and foremost, thanks to Dr. Robert Budman as the director of the Robert Wood Johnson Center for Health Policy, who supported the Institute. I'd also like to thank all the students and staff at the center who worked so hard to make this happen, and in particular, Antoinette Maestas. I can acknowledge all the work she's put into this. She's amazing. I'd like to thank our co-sponsors, Dr. Sharon Bodis, Vice President of the Division of Student Services. Dr. Deli Alcantara, Director of Conference at UNM Geospatial Population Studies, UNM Mellon Fellowship Program with UNM Department of Sociology, Dr. Valerie Romero-Leggett, Health Sciences Office for the Vice Chancellor for Diversity. And finally, now I'm introducing, sorry for the long introduction, but there was a lot of information that I needed to share with you. And I'll introduce the roundtable speakers after our break. Dr. Clara Rodriguez, who's in the audience, raise your hand, and we actually didn't discuss who would go first, but you're welcome to, or we have Dr. Clara, so we'll just follow the schedule as it says. Dr. Clara Rodriguez is a professor of sociology at Fordham University College of Lincoln Center in New York. She's the author of 10 books including Changing Race, Latino, the Census, and the History of Ethnicity in the United States. His planning for the labor force, issues and policies, Association for Distinguished Contributions to Research in the Field of Latino Studies, and she's been a visiting professor at Columbia and MIT in Yale. Dr. Matthew Smith, if you raise your hand. Oklahoma Cherokee Choctaw is professor of Humanities and Social Sciences in the Department of Sociology at Stanford and directs the Center for the Comparative Study of Race and Ethnicity and the Institute for Research in the Social Science Data Center. He has published 3 books, 70 articles, on demography, economic development, and he served on the Census Bureau Racial and Ethnic Advisory Committee. He also holds a PhD from the University of Wisconsin in Management and Sociology. And Dr. Kenneth Pruitt, who raises his hand, is a Harvard Professor of Public Affairs and Vice President at Columbia University and Vice President of the Centers at Columbia. In addition to teaching to men for many years at the University of Chicago. He has served as the director of the United States Census Bureau in the year 2000. He also has published many books, The Hard Count, The Political and Social Challenges of Social Mobilization, Politics and Science and Census Taking, The Legitimacy of Foundations, and now he's currently completing America's Statistical Ratings, which we still need them to still want them. So I welcome Dr. Pruitt to lead off our presentation.
There's been a lot of talk, this issue, about the fact that our invasive and unnecessary and colon, confusing to the respondents as well as the scientists as well as the policymakers. And there's a lot of discussion now about, well, maybe we should make a change. There are various ideas about what kinds of changes we might make. I won't review them all in this minute, but I'm not is there a better way to do this than the way that we're doing it? So I skipped all this, get rid of the ones we've got. I do not want to put out a recommendation that I do not and that is politically acceptable. And so here's some guidelines I follow as I think about making some changes. No abrupt change. There's enormous inertia in any statistical system. If you think you're going to change overnight, you're wrong. Secondly, what is the time frame? We normally say, well, we did the 2010 census, we're going to get a change before the 2020. Now we're doing the 2020, we're going to get a change before. Should have in mind is a generation. Be alert to the fact that statistics not. Now I'll talk about what I mean by that in a second. And finally, modify the voter. So no abrupt changes either in the structure, but also abrupt changes in the actual questions themselves. Well, given those kinds of guidelines, those kinds of rules, how in the world can we make any serious change? This is the question I want to make a difference between and race question. What is this person's population group? These are the same five fundamental races in the current census. I take. This was supposed to be alphabetical. Sorry, it isn't. I want it to be alphabetical. In race classification. But my important point is, I want to follow this. It does not use the word race. I want the same treatment for race. I want to try to get the word race out of the government's vocabulary. I am not thinking we'll get out of the larger vocabulary for a very long time. But I do not want the federal government to try to tell us what race is for. On the other hand, I do not think we can raise that we currently have for now. So that would be my first. Secondly, I would say, now, the ethnic origin question. I think we ought to throw that question away. I think it's not very good to use for political purposes. The reason that I believe this question will work, what is this person's national origin? This is if you look at the current question, how do you know whether you're an Asian or not? Do you think? Does anybody know? You can't declare yourself on the current question some nationality. So you know whether you become an Asian. You cannot just say, I'm an Asian. You can't say I'm in a spat. There's no box. You choose a national identity. And the examples that are given under all of these questions are always national identity. immigration question, says where were you born, or where was your place of birth, that's not currently on the So my new frame for census questions is one very simple population
leave and the book that mentioned changing the census and the history of ethnicity in the United States is that experience of that the really illustrates the social construct of this. Well, and raise the question of what is race, given the way that we talk. And so I was asked to panel at the American Sociological Association, I'll panel with Anne Morning, who does some excellent work. And we were both asked the question that should we get rid of the race question? It's very, very interesting. Anne and I are very good friends, but we came up with a very similar question.
Not yet.
Try my mind. So I said, this was late 90s, early. No, we should not get rid of the question on race. Especially, I didn't think the world was ready for it. I didn't think that we could go forward. I think gathering information like this is important. I think that's a good thing to draw this problem. But I said, on the other hand, be much more optimistic. So, and when I wrote the book, I didn't take a position on this question. However, I'm ready to take a position now. And I thought that Professor Pruitt and I were different, but it's really not that different, actually. And to bother the statistician with my suggestion. Position today. I think that we should keep the race question. I also think we should keep the race category, which creates all kinds of havoc. What if I mean? So, and then I think we should have a simple, and I think we should eliminate what is an identifier. I think we should keep the race category. I don't think we're quite there where we can just eliminate the question. But I do think that there's a lot to be said for why just have one national organization. Therefore, the second question that I will include is the whole question of whether that's technically feasible or politically acceptable.
back to the early 1990s, out there, the 1990 census was a watershed in the sense that nobody across a very diverse range of change otherwise fixed. And so there was a meeting by the Office of Management and Budget at the National Academy of Science, and this large workshop of different individuals from academia as well as this community. And Barbara and Leo may have been in this meeting as well. In 1994, came a set of principles for revising the race classification. But you can see, things like categories should be mutually exclusive. And the data should be reliable, even if it's disaggregated by race and ethnicity. Went on to producing this sort of eight. Be mindful of things about efficiency. The first implementation of the 2000 census question. Hopefully all of you, had a chance to complete the process all last year. And you probably remember this is what the question. Quite a large question, and it takes up a lot of questions. To talk about some of the problems there were 13 categories that can be combined into these ways. So you have 126 discrete categories. Now there was a question in the 2000 census, and Kenny has said, but there was no dilemma at the Bureau about whether to publish the data for a subset of categories. Because if you published all the data for all categories, hundreds and hundreds of blank pages. Talking about which categories you need to pay attention to for purposes of civil rights. But the thing is that I think is really striking is that these two principles that came from the earlier conference, that the data should be reliable and disaggregated by race. Think about disaggregating by 126 different categories. Yeah.
All right, I'm going to announce it up. So, where does this leave us? The produce the current classification, but the implementation has been and I think I'm looking forward to hearing today because I think the Census Bureau has got a study underway that actually is going to shed some light on this. And so, I'm not bold enough to make a recommendation. I think I would go along with Ken's comment that expands the put into the combined regulation. But beyond that, I'm going to proceed. I'll only say that that was my last comment.
So it's
Thank you, Ben. In a follow-up, that people are looking toward 2020, at what point in the process can be the public weigh in? And you heard you mentioned the hearings and the moments for comments. You could just make myself and the audience aware of what point in time you guys should be looking for opportunities to comment or opportunities to voice opinions.
Well, I was considered this is part of that process. I mean, any group that you want to come from December or in Europe or whatever wants to have a conference or panel.
Just the census, which I think has to be. How many questions can be be asked on the census. You're talking about research, conducting research or survey. I think a very important question. I think that can be raised differently, but essentially I think we need to get a sense because the case is because of all the work experience different society and wanting to study your neighbor and not just act in any way or be a so I think an important question to include in the survey is what race do you have other people.
However, a very important book on immigration policy, there are a tremendous lot of math by the Russell State Foundation. Really intricate, complicated stuff. It tells you nothing about New York. It's about the conditions of New York. Source that's going to give you these data. Census in 2010 was $14 billion. So if we don't figure out a way to get better data out of the system, how do we understand the assimilation processes over the next half century and the problem and the social inclusion problem?
Thank you. trying to help you, letting us actually show those indigenous races.
Well, I've been working on this issue, and that's why I think it's possible, I'm not certain about this, but I think it's possible to clean national origin question. The current ancestry question says, what's your ancestry and ethnic origin? The answers, by the way, are about national origins. The people from the Census Bureau, about how they report all national origin. So I think the population can think about national origin and give you all kinds of detail. The other thing about the American Indian population that matters, but not, is you actually get higher counts of American Indians in this country from the ancestry question than you get from the race question. If they don't match, you can't use the two data sets because they don't match. You get different counts of Asians, you get different counts of everything. The way I have structured it, you will not, that will not happen. Subcategories with respect to the five umbrella groups. And all the subcategories that come in the national origin question, what I would hope is you will get the kind of, what I hope is the Native American population will really use that to count. If there turn out to be 2 million federal tribes, 7 million federal tribes, 7 million African population, we ought to know about that. We ought to know they're getting health care. We ought to know they're getting educated. And if we only do the enrollable tribe, we're missing the population, which I don't think we should do. So I'm trying to figure out a way to doesn't lose that.
Well, I think you hit the, because there are these people, as you say, who aren't necessarily members of tribes, and we don't know a lot about them, except for what we can be paying for the census, but there is a constituency out there that we're seeing in the census, all those other folks, off folks, and not anywhere.
People in the United States right now, which is why I think that students have a lot of Native American independence, who really never participate in anything that is remotely.
There was an enterprising reporter from the engaged in a very sort of difficult exercise of trying to decide who was. And what they finally end up doing now is that you have to provide proof that you're an enrolled member of a tribe within the state of Michigan. And that's where it stands. We did give rise to an interesting term called term of ethnic fraud.
I would also say that the people who apply to law school, even though it's not a requirement, as an example, Michigan, that case, I think it makes the person more interesting. Why do we think that American Indian identity is definitely a big question, but I also think it shed the light.
Vicky Ibarra, who has volunteer to pose the first question. The rules are, if you can pose your question in 30 seconds or a minute or less, the more concise it is, the more we'll have the ability to hear all the voices that are present here. Thank you.
Thank you. I wonder if the panel could speak to a little bit about the political influence into the decision-making process about changing the question. We know that it goes beyond just the good science we've heard about here today, that there are political processes. Primarily to pick up multiple race responses. Okay?
like. We forgot the view. Literally, it was an oversight. And then, 18, 17 million Hispanics put themselves down on that line. And they became a constituency for that question in the Hispanic population. I think by going to what I suggested, or maybe what Nicholas will provide you this afternoon, is a way out of that problem. It doesn't get a purchase on it.
Introduce this idea of permanent action and basic. create what a vision is. But some people say it never meant.
Dr. Swift, did you want to?
Multitude, welcome to UNM in New York. I'm Rick Wood, the faculty member of the Department of Sociology. This has been a great discussion. I don't think about this terrain. It's been great to just sit in on this. So thank you all. So it's going to be a political process, a political decision. I'd like to ask a question on that terrain. You're not political actors, but you're well located to have some thoughts on this, and if you can help us know. If it's a political process, we need to know who our opponents. And I'm especially curious what we know about the Tea Party, the congressional representatives in Congress affiliated with the Tea Party in one form or another. Are they pressuring the OMB and the census one direction or another in how race and ethnicity are pressured in this country? What's their strategy? What are they thinking about the 2020 census? I think that's really critical to be thinking about it.
Thank you. And I just want to remind anyone who wants to ask the question to just come. If you could answer briefly, that would be great.
The political opponents basically travel on the political line. The political opponents want to get the question out of it altogether. Newt Gingrich was behind, very strongly behind the multiple race option because he saw that as a step to moving past the race categories as we have seen them confusing the whole system. It's a very deliberate strategy. But the more important power there has been simply saying, got to get it. And Justice Roberts himself has made noises in the direction of why we even have this question. There's an anti-classification interpretation of the 14th Amendment. I didn't go there because I didn't have enough time. One of the reasons I suggested to get the word race out of the question is to have a firewall against the colorblind opponents of any kind of classification at all. Because they don't like the implications of any kind of race-based
I just have to reply to that only because I think we need to clarify what the conceptual basis of race is. If we're saying that we can't even hold the concept, then we again are perpetuating the idea that this is not a valid category of analysis. And we know from studies that show, again, that entire communities, individuals experience racial stigma and exclusion, that to get rid of the word is not going to get rid of that reality. And I understand that strategically you're saying let's get rid of it because they're going to do it before we do, but that reality cannot be captured in a vote.
I hope I don't make my personal brain go to the audience today.
No. Yes, I know that. Some of them do because I presented this model.
Racializing this group.
Dr. Smith, did you want to intervene here?
Political, but it's really a question of power, and you know, the opposite of that, which is obviously powerlessness. And so I would offer kind of a black. And then second, to sort of ask a follow-up question, which would be more specifically around, do you consider yourself or are you from an oppressed group or a privileged group? Which would actually ask the question of power, which really, you know, is very pointed to the question of power, which to me is what the study is really all about.
So we literally have each person could take 1 or 2 minutes, and I know there are a lot of questions, but whatever you feel to reply to. And we'll start with Dr. Smith.
Well, I mean, there's lots of ways to cut this, but the idea of using color has been proposed, a number of times. But again, the devil's always in the details, because color doesn't match up very well with what people think of as their race, however they might happen to think about it. I think that's it's a slippery slope, and then what do you do? You can pass out gray scales or brown scales to people to match up their skin. I mean, sort of that process, as Nick has mentioned earlier, you have people who, they have different skin tones. My son's a great deal darker in the summer than he is in the winter. I think it's problematic, and I'll just let that go.
Thank you. be able to use them. But OMB to say, we don't talk about races. We talk about who you are. You fill in the blank. You tick a box. OMB talks about ethnicity, but doesn't use it on the form. I think that's good that they don't use it on the form. So, race six times on the form. They said, my God, there's nothing more important than you telling us what your race is. And that migrates into all other kinds of avenues. Migrates into media, migrates into film, novels, and so forth. Do I think the race is going away? Of course not. Do I think discrimination is going away? Of course not. I'm trying to protect the statistical system that allows us to look at disparities, looks at inclusion, and lowers the temperature enough so that we don't get a Supreme Court ruling. No, you can laugh, but it is not true. And so there is a political strategy in my head, but I also think it's an ethical strategy. I actually think, look, I said we will ask this question, but only for 30 more years, generation, because by then, people over 65 are dead. That's where the handle is on the old categories. And the people who are coming up have never had the experience of having been asked the race question on the census, because they are just a day younger than after 25 years and it's gone, et cetera, et cetera. If you think generationally and you want a strategy, then why in the world do you want to handle on the same categories we're dealing with today? It's really, really a mistake.
Thank you for this really compelling and provocative roundtable. In 10 minutes, we're going to reconvene again and have the second round table. And if you haven't done so already, please fill out an evaluation form and indicate it was round table one and sign it as well. Thank you. So 2:40 will start promptly with the second.